capture and arrest of George Metesky, also known as the Mad Bomber, would change the way in which the police would seize criminals forever. It was the first known use of criminal profiling, but who was this infamous New York bomber? George Metesky, born in 1903, was the son of Lithuanian immigrants. Metesky had a job as a mechanic at the United Industrial Light and Power Company, which was a subsidiary of Consolidated Edison, better known as Con Edison. While on the job in 1931, a boiler had backfired. This boiler proceeded to spit hot gases upon Metesky, the fumes filling his lungs. He was disabled for 26 weeks because of the hot boiler flame that he had inhaled. During those miserable weeks, George Metesky was fired from Con Edison. Metesky had filed a workers' compensation claim, but it was denied because he had waited a bit too long to file it. Furthermore, his three appeals were also denied. Because of this horrible situation, George Metesky had developed a deep and untrusting loathing for those who had terminated him, Consolidated Edison. On November 16, 1940, Metesky's first bomb was found on a window ledge in a Con Edison building. This bomb didn't explode. It seemed that it was never supposed to go off. On the outside of the bomb, there was a note that said, "Con Edison crooks, this is for you." The police would eventually drop this first case. In September of 1941, there was another undetonated bomb found a couple of blocks away from the Con Edison office on Irving Place. This bomb was similar to the bomb that was found the first time. It was hidden in an old sock. These two bombs had drawn very little attention. The bomber had sent a letter to the police headquarters that said that he would stop until the war was over. Also in his note, he promised to get justice, saying, "I will bring the Con Edison to justice. They will pay for their dastardly deeds." He signed it FP. Many of his letters would be signed with the letters FP. Even though he made good on his promise not to plant bombs during the war, these types of menacing letters continued to the police and Con Edison throughout its duration. Investigators were able to guess that he had a European education because of the shapes of his G's and Y's in his letters. On March 29, 1950, almost a full 9 years after his last bomb, another bomb was discovered in Grand Central Station. This bomb was the first to go off, setting off a new age of bombs from the Mad Bomber. In a phone booth inside of the New York Public Library, another bomb detonated, then another at Grand Central Station. Over the course of the next 5 years, the Mad Bomber planted almost 30 more bombs throughout New York. Some prominent locations include Penn Station and Radio City Music Hall. Those first two unexploded bombs bothered few. These numerous bombs in a short period of time put the public on edge. None of his bombs killed anyone. He was able to plant a total of 33 bombs, of which 22 exploded. 15 individuals would be injured by him. In a letter to the New York Herald Tribune, it was revealed that he attacked the public because he wanted the public to cry justice for him. He wrote, "Bombs will continue until the Consolidated Edison Company is brought to justice for their dastardly acts against me. I have exhausted all other means. I intend with the bombs to cause others to cry out for justice for me." The bombs would range in size from 4 to 10 inches and would usually be found in a sock at the location. The bombs would be made of gunpowder with their timers made of cheap watches and flashlight batteries. After a 16-year investigation and after many distractions and false reports, the NYPD went to James A. Brussel, who had performed counterintelligence profiling work during the Korean War and World War II. This psychiatrist was able to develop a complex profile of the Mad Bomber. The bomber was predicted to be a male from Eastern Europe between the ages of 40 and 50, a single man living with his female relatives, and a clean-shaven athletic man, and a paranoid. A famous prediction was when Brussel had predicted that the bomber would be wearing a buttoned, double-breasted suit, which Metesky had been wearing when he was arrested. His case of profiling had been published in the newspapers. Alice Kelly, a Con Edison clerk, was able to find the file on the Mad Bomber. She was able to see that there were many similarities between his case files and from his letters that were published in the publication Journal American. One similarity was Metesky's use of the phrase "dastardly deeds." The police would be notified and the Waterbury police would do a discreet check on George Metesky, the Mad Bomber. The NYPD officially credited Alice Kelly with finding the clue that led to his arrest, so she would be the one who would receive the $26,000 reward, but she declined, saying that she had just been doing her job. $26,000 from 1957 in today's money would be $239,346, almost $240,000. When Metesky was arrested, the police asked for a writing sample. When they got the sample back from Metesky, they asked him what FP stood for. Metesky said that it stood for fair play. Metesky also showed the cops his workshop in his garage, where he would make the bombs. During his interrogation, he gave the cops the locations of 15 more previously unknown bombs. During his trial, Metesky was declared legally insane, a paranoid schizophrenic, so he was committed to the Matteawan Asylum for the Criminally Insane. When he was released in 1973, he moved home to Connecticut, where he stayed until 1994, when he had died. If you enjoyed this video, why not give it a like? Also, while you're here, why don't you subscribe?